Alright, Shalom. Shalom in the Rastafari home, in the house of Rastafari, in the base of Rastafari. We want to continue with this teaching, asking the question at the house, is Rastafari culture? Is Rastafari spirituality? Is Rastafari religion? And we're continuing in this commentary, but also teaching connected with that particular vid that we uploaded concerning the Rastafari, that we say the Rasta waived his natural and his religious right. And it's a very interesting object lesson. You know, we commented here or there because we just got the heads up at the last moment on it, and we touched on some of that already in the previous postings. Hopefully these would have been posted, the ones we already recorded would have been posted by now. You checked it out, the one on here, and here exemption and hat and cord, Rasta hat and cord and here exemption. And just the contrast is the point that we want to contrast with the fact that when certain of the brethren get are arrested and get incarcerated and try to defend their legal right, or they don't know where to put it, they just put it under culture and it gets struck down, just as the Rasta in court got struck down. And under spirituality, they will ask the probing, what they call in court, a probative question. There's a probative question, and if you look at that particular clip, again, you'll see where he said this is part of his culture, wearing the hat is a part of his culture. He didn't check up on hat, that a hat is this. This is a hat, right? This right here we call a tam. You understand? This we call a tam. Sometimes people make the mistake or the confusion between this and this. But in a legal sense, it can be devastating to your claims. It can totally destroy your particular claim. And then if you try to backpedal, basically your testimony in the square, and we use the tabernacle here, right, of that square, where this principle of court, we say even in the Psalms, and in the Bible, it speaks about the courts of the Lord, the courts of Jah. In the courts of Jah, we have to learn how to behave in the courts of Jah. And in this liberty, you understand, that we call Rastafari, liberty, using that word nostalgically speaking, what we left off here in the Psalms, because I want to connect for you what was written in the second epistle of Johannes, the grace of Yah, with what we have when it says, if anyone does not abide in the doctrine, if they do not live in the doctrine. From the scriptures, the more proper word in Hebrew and among Jews and in Judaism is called the halakha. The halakha. The halakha means the walk. In the New Testament, you'll find that word as our walking Christ. You will find that word as our conversation. Now, if you read it without that knowledge, if you read the Bible without that knowledge, and you see the translation where it says, and let your conversation in Christ, or speak up when it speaks about conversation, you might think it's talking about talking. You think it's talking about, oh, I was having a conversation with somebody. That's not really the original use of it. Conversation in the Bible, in the New Testament especially, is connected with the other form of translation known as walk. What is our walk? Where it says that, and some who claim to be Christian, their walk is funny, their halakha, their way of life. In other words, they say they're Christian, but they don't live according to the teachings, you understand, of Christ. In other words, they're not bearing true and faithful testimony according to the word of Christ. And that's the root of the covenant, even the new covenant. Bamarinya, we say Kal Kidan. A kidan is an agreement. It's something that covers something, right? A al kidan is a word agreement. In other words, they say one thing, but their work does not align with what their professed faith is. You know what I'm saying? So just explain that right there. The more proper word is halakha. The word halakha. And do a little bit of maybe Wikipedia search. Wiki right now is a good free resource for right now. Maybe they'll try to change it later on, but at the present, it's a pretty good straight on resource for us. So in these studies, we refer to that. Now, we put case law over here, as you recall from the previous bit, case law, and it was connected with what was said in the Megiddo Part 2, Megiddo 2 DVD. So check it out on the YouTube to the Megiddo 1 as well. But in Megiddo 2, they speak about the false religion of evolution, right? Of evolution and how evolution, which is a belief, evolution is not science in the level of science. It's not like knowledge because the evidence does not back up what they say. In fact, there's something very racist, or very questionably racist about the whole evolution and Darwin thing, because people know this book as Origin of Species. Origin of Species. It should be the Origin of Feces, really. But he calls it the Origin of Species, right? Darwin. And Darwin, actually, we get to learn, he plagiarizes his own uncle who wrote a book previous to him. But it seemed like his uncle probably recognized God or recognized a God connection to it, and he wanted to take it in a different way. But if you look at the whole title of Darwin's preface, known as Origin of Species, it has, you know, like they would have like a long title, like in some of the books that we're republishing, a long title. And the first title, which is Origin of Species, and what they call the subtitle today, is The Preservation of the Favored Races in the Struggle for Life. The preservation of the what? Favored races. So his theory is that there are some races, right? There are some races which are favored, and some races which are not favored. In other words, there are some noble races, and this is where we get this whole white supremacy, this evil, this affront to the Almighty God and every sentient creature in the universe. And we're speaking about our brothers from other planets too. You understand? Because they're also listening in. Wherever they hear the word of truth, they listen in too as well. So this video, check it out for yourself, and I'm mentioning that because I want to take this down. I want to take this down so I get a little more room, right? And we'll go into a little more on evolution as well. But that vid actually gives you some of the basic information, right? Some of the basic information to really look over. So check out that video, Case Law, and see how the evolution thing, which is basically a belief. It's a belief, like a religion. And worse yet, it connects with this false idea of so-called white supremacy or European supremacy, because that's why the subtitle is The Preservation of the Favored Races. That's why you see a lot in the media about, oh, these people were born in such a situation, why did God do this to them? So, well, really, it's men and people who are responsible. They always like to blame God, like we said, to blame Haile Selassie the first. People say, oh, Haile Selassie the first is the reason why some so-called haphazard Abbasids say is the reason why Ethiopia, you understand, is all messed up. And really the question you should ask them, what are you doing? What have you done? What has your family done? You understand, if you really want to, you know, instead of them taking responsibility, it's easy to play the blame game. And so we should also be cautious of that, and this is why we are checking ourselves and saying, is it right that we say Rastafari is not a so-called religion in the sense of, and let's put some quotes around this, a quote religion in defense of the teaching of His Majesty. See, this really prompts us to go forward, you understand, forward ever and backward never. But some have gotten stuck in this folklore of Rastafari, you understand, like as a folk culture, even with this old Smithsonian thing that Jake Homiak and others kind of did, and there was a controversy around it, you know, with Rastafari and the Smithsonian and everything. Usually it's distinct cultures, you understand, or defunct cultures that are usually put into the Smithsonian, you know, is that not correct? But now even the word culture is interesting, because if you break that word down, right, what culture really means in its real context vis-a-vis Rastafari, the teaching of His Majesty, says that language is the key of culture. So when we ask, well, Rastafari, right, how do we define Rastafari? Do we define it according to our Western Gentile-based miseducation and ignorance? Or do we make our wills obedient to good influences and study to show ourselves approved to Jah, to God, as workmen, and that's the woman included, the sister included, that need not be ashamed rightly dividing or explaining the word of truth? Because when we can rightly now understand these things, then one can recognize why we made a point out of that video. Like we said, not a personal, we're talking about principle. I'm not talking about that particular brethren. We don't know what he knew or not didn't know. What we do know is that what he did set a precedent for the rest of us, especially in the legal system. And many of us might have been before judges, and I myself have been before judges or courts, so forth and so on, and we kept our crown on. We kept our tam on. In some cases, they didn't ask us anything. I guess maybe it's how you present yourself. In other cases, they did, and we explained to them briefly, we understand that it is a same way of life. Yes, it's not my way of life, my religion, my spirituality. Now, when the judge asks the particular Rasta, he said culture, spirituality, and she probative, asked a probative question of spirituality. You mean like in the sense of religion? And before she finished her query or inquiry, he already said, I could take it off. It's like she began some questions to question him, and he already waived his right. Which kind of begs the question, why did you walk in there to begin with? You knew where he was going. He was going into their square. You understand? Don't you know how to behave in the square? Now, you have to recognize the connection between the court and the holy tabernacle. You really need to understand the principles that connect. Remember, it says that we don't war against flesh and blood. You understand? But against, like, principalities, against, you know, the rulers and these powers of ignorance and disilluminati, of darkness. This is what we wrestle against. It's a spiritual warfare, firstly and foremostly. It's a shame when it has to degenerate into a physical warfare. You understand? But it's usually because people don't recognize that the head of the warfare is spiritual first. You understand? In spirit and in truth. So spirit, we're not knocking the word, and you should know this, spirituality. We cannot knock this word if we are to be faithful to the teachings of His Imperial Majesty. Now, what we was connecting right here was the fact that His Majesty said to make our wills obedient to good influences and to avoid evil. To avoid evil. Avoid it. Avoid evil is to show the greatest wisdom. In order to follow this aim, if this is our true aim as Rastafari, the King of Kings says to us, one must be guided. Guidance. What happens to that word? Guidance and protection, my brothers and sisters. One must be guided by religion. Now, we have to define the word religion. And now in the break, we were able to locate, you understand, locate this work right here, Ethiopic grammar. Right? Ethiopic grammar. These are more of the, like, the study books, the reference books. You understand? These are some of the reference books. So it's just like, in a sense, when you go to college or university, what we're doing with the lineage of society. You understand? We have to study, show ourselves the proof, and there's real work for us to do in this world. You understand? And once you get your foundation, your house on the right foundation, you understand, that right foundation, no other foundation but the Moshiach, Yeshua, can be built upon. You understand? I want to just say this for a moment, because some, you know, we want to deal with the whole question about, is Haile Selassie God? Because how we address, answer, or deal with that question is really crucial.
Mm-hmm.
It's really very, very crucial for us to, you know, to deal with this particular matter right here. But you know what? We'll address that in its own volume. We still have a little bit more to address with this. Now, what about the language? The King of Kings says that the key of culture, his word key of culture, Haile Selassie the first said that the key of culture, right, that language is the key of culture and communication between man and man. So the key of culture, his imperial majesty gives us that key of culture in our pure language. Now, why do we say it's our pure language? Remember, we still have to put some tabernacle, dwelling, liberty, to see how all these things really relate. You know what I'm saying? Liberty, when we use the patois, that's more nostalgic. It's not really operable in the world. It's not operable in the world. It was operable amongst the Rastafari. And that's where it probably should have stayed, but this also has, you know, descended into the world. Now everybody is talking little kind of Rasta-ish kind of stuff, and then we take them as though they are called and chosen, have chosen this, and seek to be faithful to it, and it causes confusion. And since what we did the bit, Rastaism and Rastafari, because everything else, our blessing, our provision, is all based on whether we are properly aligned, whether we are building on the rock. Are we building our house on the rock? You understand? Or are we building it on the sand? And that response of the brethren kind of showed us kind of shifty sand, because there was no foundation. Because he almost, basically he said, I'll take it off. And that's what we mean, that he waived his right. And we're not saying that this brethren wasn't acting wild and crazy or nothing like that, but it helps us in this issue of sovereignty. When we're looking at the global issue, when we're looking at our economy, you know, our economy, when we're speaking about commerce, when we're speaking about enjoying the life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. You understand? Because faith says that Christ came to give us life, and life more abundantly. But then if we look at things, you say, well, why aren't we experiencing this? You understand? Is it that Christ is not true, or His majesty is not true? Or is it something that we are doing, or thinking, or not thinking, or not keeping in heart, you know, and in mind, and in consciousness, and acting off of, that has created this present inertia and this backward sort of a situation.
Mm-hmm.
So, with that being said, religion. Now, I brought this book out for a particular reason, and let's see if I have the highlight in here. I've touched on it in another series of vids, but it was a footnote highlight when studying this particular book, and it'll be good for one to get the basic Fidel, the basic Hahu, you understand, the basic Hahu in order, because then it doesn't have a transcription. But it explained a little bit about the word religion from an Ethiopic perspective. That means, are we looking at this with Western spectacles, or are we looking at this from our with Ethiopian spectacles? How are we viewing Rastafari? Are we viewing Rastafari as a from a Gentile? You understand? Goyim, lost sheeple, artificial person, or is it true to what we say is natural, according to our natural, God-given, God-given rights? You know, so I'm not too sure if I footnoted this right here, if I highlighted this, but it touches on it a couple of places in here. I'll go over it again with the eye then. But it's in this particular book. This is a particular study resource, like kind of a reference resource. But it'll be fundamental to spend time studying the fidels. You understand? The fidels, the glyphs, the syllables of the syllabary. You understand? Of the Ethiopic and of the Amharic. You understand? That's the first grade to get, in a sense, your doctorate or your basic of letters. You know, get your letters. Get the letters first. You know, they have like doctor of letters and doctor of law, so forth and so on. So the Torah is a foundation for us right there. And what I wanted to put up here is the name of the true faith is called this. And I'm gonna put this in our the key of our culture, which is the language. You know what I'm saying? And this is our language. You know what I'm saying? What does the language mean? Remember, many still say that Rastafari means head creator, while in Amharic, Fetari means creator, and Teferi means the one to be referenced. Teferi, Fetari. You hear how close they are? Fetari, Teferi. But anyone, even a basic child, you know, a lich overstands the difference between that. But for many, decades, somehow into Rastafari and into the movement has crept in. You understand? It's almost like a virus in the program, in the word matrix of it. And we say word, sound, and power. So if we have the word wrong, then the sound of it is going to be wrong. Then the power or the authorization is going to be wrong as well. And that's very key for us to understand. But in the language, we call it the RETU'A, right? Some say the RETU'A, in some forms of conjugating the word the RETU'A. But here's the key word right here: HAYMANOT, right? So something like this: the RETU'A, HAYMANOT. That is the HAYMANOT. That is the true word in the Ethiopic for so-called a religion. And it actually means living faith or life faith. HAYMANOT. HAYMANOT is the contraction of these two particular words. And in Ethiopic grammar, the great Dillman, you understand, the German Dillman, he went in some real details. In other words, he had a high regard or an honor, you understand, for the language. He was one who was able to recognize the value of the Ethiopic language, and it's I faith that the Holy Spirit enlightened him, and he was able to leave us this excellent testimony, this and many other works, including the Ethiopic Torah, or the Octatech, you understand, the first eight books, as opposed to the Pentateuch, or in comparison with the Pentateuch, all right? And just a basic review right there, right? Just a basic review on that. The RETU'A, RETU'A, RETU'A. I think I'll put a RETU'A here, a RETU'A. And let's just do like this. Here we go. RETU'A, HAYMANOT. All right. Now, where were we? We were actually at Psalm 15 because we were touching on dwelling, and the reason about dwelling because the sense of abiding, dwelling is the liberty. You understand? To live in something. You understand? To live in something or one's akahed or halakha. Halakha is the Hebrew, and that means one's conduct, how they conduct oneself, one's behavior. King James translates it in a couple of places in the New Testament, or it's translated William White Tyndale, actually, but King James published it. But anyway, it's translated as conversation. But it's also used in its root sense of abiding, the act of abiding, dwelling. So we've had Mezmor Dawit 15, Asav Amis, and it says the Psalm of David, David, Lord Adonai, Abitu, my father, his father, Yeshua's father, O father of the house of the true Christian, or the Beta Christian, in this revelation time, the Beta Rastafari, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who is it who can dwell in your tabernacle? In other words, who can dwell in this tabernacle? Who can live in this holy place? You see, so taking this name upon Ayanot in spirit and in truth is receiving the kiddush or the holy upon us. So we must grow up. This is why the Galatians says that the Torah, the law, is a schoolmaster. The law is like our nanny. It's like bar mitzvah. We're going through the basic bar mitzvah, the Rastafari bar mitzvah level of study, which is crucial, is the foundation. Even the King of Kings says that one must have secular knowledge, worldly knowledge. But first and foremost, one must have scriptural, or that biblical, the RETU'A HAYMANOT. You must know of the true faith, right? Of the true faith. Sometimes it's translated as the, quote, orthodox faith. Remember the key of the letters and the language, right? And this is one of the reasons why we have various places in the scripture, like I think Zephaniah 3 and 9 and 10, where it says, for he will turn to us. You understand? A pure language that we all may call upon the name of Yahweh, of he who is who he is, the living one, the God of the living, with one consent, right? With one consent, so no confusion. The confusion is because we're not all calling, turning to that pure language that he has turned to us, so we're all not calling upon him with one consent. One is saying one thing because he feel like it, because it sounds good to him, the next one saying the next thing, so forth and so on. And we don't even recognize that the enemy now is using that disunity, that disobedience against us individually, collectively, our life, our liberty, our pursuit of happiness, our funds, our financing, our economy. I mean, is there anything really more important than that, you understand, on this earth? So it says, Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle? Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? Who shall dwell in your holy hill? So the holiness, once again, is reaffirmed there. It says, he that walketh uprightly. Once again, the idea of an upright walk. And the idea of upright is not just, well, yes, physically, you know, stand upright. You know what I'm saying? Stand up straight, as they say. Like, man up. You understand? But it's also speaking of uprightness, being straightforward. You understand? Being straightforward, kinenet. You understand? Kinenet. Being straightforward. Now with that being said, he says, and worketh righteousness. Now, people say, well, righteousness is what we get in that grace and that acceptance of Yeshua. But now, if we accept it in spirit and in truth, it begins to perfect us. We begin to grow. We begin to check how we speak. We begin to check how we think. We begin to check which particular words we use and which particular words we don't use. And so, you know, in order to be worthy of that, but we recognize the value, you understand, of Yeshua, you understand, of Yeshua's his sacrifice for I and I, to restore us into the family of our Father, his Father, of Abba, even Abba Kadus, Kadus Abba Tachin. So working righteousness, You understand? It's a heart. It's simply a function of the heart. Because the heart truly is being conformed, the consciousness, then it's basically easy, you understand? Easier to, over time, to practice, make perfect, and to correct ourselves and to check ourselves. You understand? And speaketh the truth in his heart. So he speaks the truth in his heart. And then, and so that affects us in such a deeper, really abiding way, because the heart is our consciousness. So we talk about Rastafari is about consciousness also. It's about a higher consciousness. In what sense? In what context? It's about Yeshua's consciousness. It's about Christ's consciousness in its essence. You understand? So the beauty of it is that Haile Selassie's own testimony verifies that word for us in spirit and in truth. So there's no excuse to anyone who says, yes, I love Selassie, I love Haile Selassie, and I'm Rastafari. Well, you have to check out what it is, you understand, that you say that you are of, you understand, and conform yourself. Otherwise, it's like identity theft. One is using the name Rastafari almost with no intention, you understand, of living up. You understand? And that is a crime. That is a high crime, even on the level of treason. You understand? In the sense of the highest sort of, and blasphemy is all connected with that. You understand? Now, many of us are in ignorance and have been in ignorance. You understand? So the scripture says that he winks at the times of disobedience and ignorance. This is why he's sending I and I and other ones forward, and the word is coming forward, so ones will have no excuse. You understand? No excuse. They haven't heard the word, because what preacher or a true proclaimer of the good news of his imperial majesty and his Christ, you understand, either has not been sent or they have not received it, you understand? But it's I and I's job to or I and I's work in job, you understand, is to save souls. Not that we do the saving, but the word, the truth, you understand, does it. Now, it says, he that backbiteth not with his tongue, don't backbite with your tongue, nor doeth evil to his neighbor. Our neighbor, and this also goes right back to the cultural root of it, which is the language, you understand, the divine heritage. When we look at the word, now, where it says neighbor is vale ingera, right? And that is to mean one who has bread. But if you understand the meso, I don't know if you understand what a meso is. It's that circular table. You might have seen it in an Ethiopian restaurant, the traditional table. You understand? It's like the Passover, really, table, because the bread can be put down there, the flat bread, the kita, can be put down there. The food goes on top of it, like the injera, and all eat out of a common plate, out of a common feeding area. So one who has injera, one who has bread, you understand, is your neighbor in that sense. It's almost the very same as the meaning of brother. You understand? One who is your brother. Like it says, who is my neighbor? You understand? Who do you eat bread? Who would you have communion with in Christ? And that connects with 2 John. 2 John was talking about the doctrine of Christ. And we haven't finished up there because we're touching on this right here. So it says, nor doeth evil to his neighbor, nor taketh up a reproach against his neighbor. So we're not seeking to hold our brother in any sense of reproach here. You understand? Because if we are following the prime directive of the King of Kings and his Christ, we're here to win souls for Christ's sake. For Christ and his kingly character's sake. You understand? Because no doubt ones and ones really have not been told these things. They've heard religion, they've heard the meaning in the Latin of religion, religio, tying back, holding down, in that kind of sense, and they've left it right there. So we ask, well, if it's to be left right there, how do we deal with what his majesty has said to us right here and elsewhere? So it goes on, two more verses for this. In whose eyes a vile person is contend, a vile person. And it's not vile by my personal standard, but vile by John's standard, by the true test of reality. right? But he honoreth them that reverence, or feareth the Lord. He honors those who reverences Yahweh, reverences Jah. He that sweareth to his own hurt and changeth not. He, one who's consistent. You know what I'm saying? He that putteth not out his money to usury. He don't lend money on interest. We're not to lend money to one another in Rastafari on interest. What? You said Rastas don't lend money to each other? Well, that's part of the problem right there. You know what I'm saying? He putteth not out his money to usury, nor taketh reward against the innocent. No, he don't take a bribe. You know, a gubo. You understand? No gubo business. Learn the word gubo. You understand? Gubo in Ethiopia is like bribe money. You understand? Like in the Nollywood movies where somebody get a little bribe or a little drink or something like that. You know, and sell their whole village, you know? He that doeth these things shall never be moved. You understand? He can stand in the tabernacle, in the holy place. Now, that holy place, Old Testament, is the macro, as we said. And in Yeshua, we are that holy place. The His spirit to abide in each of I. So we say, well, how come we don't come together? Because the spirit is not abiding in each of I. So how can I and I come together when the only true coming together are those who come together with the two or three in his name? But in his name, it's not just saying Rasta or Rastafari. It's talking about that integrity, the liberty, if you will. You understand? Of that particular name, of that holy name, of that new name. So, is Rastafari a religion? It's a religion in the sense of, one, our legal rights lawfully, you understand, among the Gentiles, among the heathen, you understand? It is a religion in the sense of the RETU'A HAYMANOT, the living faith. You understand, the true faith, you understand, by interpretation, the quote, orthodox, right, the orthodox or Tawahido faith, right? But let's continue with John here, so we can summarize this part right here. It says, whosoever transgresses, verse 9, 2 John, it's only one chapter, so we're in John, 2nd epistle of John, whosoever transgresses the transgresseth and abideth not in the doctrine. So whosoever transgresses and doesn't abide in the timheret, the teaching, get to know that word, timheret, the teaching of Christo, hath not God, doesn't have ha Elohim baruchu, to him be the praise. They don't have the sustainer. They don't have Jah. They don't have Yahweh. They don't have him. You understand? They are not in him. You understand? It's seeking to tell us and describe how to spiritually discern the deceiver, right? He that abideth in the doctrine, he who dwells, he whose liberty, if you please, is in the teaching of Christ, even Christ in his kingly character, otherwise known as the Black Messiah. You understand? He that abideth or lives in, whose liberty, way of living, way of life, is in and according to the teaching of the Anointed One, of the Moshiach, he hath both the Father and the Son. Hallelujah. Amen. He has both the Father and the Son. That is the key. That's the key of the what in ancient Egypt they called Ma'at, but it was also known as the Two Truths. And it's a very interesting verse here. People say, some say, oh, that's a New Testament thing. That's not Old Testament Judaism, but not about Father or Son or whatever like that. It's about God. You know, one God and there's no Father and Son connection. Well, hear this right here. It says, who has ascended up, this is Proverbs 30, chapter 30, who has ascended up into heaven or descended? Who? Who has ascended up into heaven or descended? Now, in the scripture, we read of Christos, Yeshua, ascending up into heaven. And we have also heard the testimony of Abba Kedus, Abba Tachin, ascending up into heaven. It says, who hath ascended up into heaven or descended, who hath gathered the wind in his fist, who hath bound the waters in a garment, who hath established all the ends of the earth, all the ends, he's talking about making ends meet. You need to check this out. Who has established all the ends of the earth? You need to check that one. You understand? The one. You understand? If you want to make so-called ends meet in righteousness, who has established all the ends of the earth? Question mark. What is his name? What is his name? Shemo. What is his name? You understand? Simu. What is his name? And what is his son's name? This is the Old Testament now. Now, understand when we talk about the Jewish Trinity and that wonderful book by Yoel Natan that we have recommended to others in private communion and reasoning. We recommend here to you all because that Jewish, I think he's a European Jew, but he's a brother in Yeshua. He recognizes, even from a Jewish perspective, the importance and role of Yeshua and proves the true Trinity or the Jewish Trinity in the Scriptures from the Hebraic perspective. And a lot of folks always said you can't do it from the Hebraic perspective. Some of us were able to, based on what we knew, but his book really sums up a lot of key and vital examples. So it says, what is his name? And what is his son's name? If thou canst tell. If you can't tell. See, folks, most folks deny it because they can't tell because of ignorance. They're saying, I don't know. They try to say it doesn't exist because they don't know. Instead of saying that they don't know if it exists, you understand, or what it is. Verse 5 says, every word of Elohim, of Ha Elohim, Baruch Hu, every word of God, if you please, is pure, a pure language. Remember Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 9 and 10? Turn to us, a pure language. Every word of God is pure. He is a shield to them that put their trust in him. Now that word trust is curious, it's interesting, because that word trust really is faith. And if you look over here in the margin, it connects with Psalm 2 and 12, and there's a note right there. And it's, for those who have a Scofield or download the Scofield from our website, LOJSociety.org, it's very interesting. We don't have time right here to go into, you know, go into this in detail, that connection on trust, but just trust that and find the truth for yourself and verify it. So it says that he is a shield to them that put their trust in him. Verse 6, add thou not to his words. Don't add to his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. Thou be found a liar. So we're not seeking to add to his majesty's word, not to add to the scripture, but to understand it in its proper context, using that God-given reasoning, recognizing that he created us in his image and after his likeness, and because he so loved his people, Yisroel, Israel, Beta Israel, even the lost sheep, he sent his son. Yovzen, he sent his son. He didn't, it didn't say he sent his son to save the world. It says he sent his son to save Israel because it was his intent that through Israel, Yovzen, that the world, the Alam, the Olam would be saved. So we as so-called black people, you know, we, on one level we can say, yes, we are made to Israel because of that, not color thing, but because of the word. And the word also testifies to our color and testifies to Yeshua's flesh. That's why it says right here is that one who confesses not that he is Christos is come in the flesh, no matter what race he was or what color or what not like that. Well, how did you ever see somebody who's no race, no color? See, that's only a big point because of white supremacy. So don't get it twisted. You know what I'm saying? We're not to become so-called black supremacists like they're white supremacists. He says, observe what they observe, but don't do after their works. Verse 10, so one who abides in the teaching of Christ, even Christ in his kingly character, right? Even Christ in his kingly character, right? He has both the Father and the Son. And through the teaching of His Majesty, it's not Haile Selassie talking about himself. It's Haile Selassie talking and demonstrating of Jesus Christus. And this is why many of us, you understand, not fully studied, we see His Majesty, we see Yeshua, we see Jesus, but He is not Yeshua. The Father is not the Son, but the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit is one. Shema Yisrael, Yahweh Eloheinu, Yahweh Ahad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord thy God is one, to say that He is in oneness, He is united. And it's interesting there too, because a lot of folks will say, no, the word Ahad, Ahad means one, like, or, you know, like ordinal, cardinal kind of thing. It means one like this. But those who have studied the language, the Hebrew, and those of us who have studied the Ethiopic, know that that Ahad is related to Tawahada, right? Where we get Tawahido or Wahid, which means to be union, be united, be one in the sense of Father, Son, Holy Spirit, one. One God, the triune God. We're going to touch on that a little bit more, because a lot of folks are still a little bit confused, because the first thing a lot of folks do is look at false trinities in the world and then try to compare the true God with the false. You know, it's like if you have a fake dollar bill and you have a real one. You have to know what is real. Then you can distinguish the fake by the real, but you can't try to prove the realness of the real by way of the fake. That's called reverse engineering. We know that the Anglo-Pians and Europeans, they like to do that. They like to reverse engineer stuff, but even their higher scientists know that there's a danger in that. There's a danger in trying to reverse engineer kind of thing. But it shows that they have to reverse engineer it because they didn't receive it to begin with. You know what I'm saying? If they receive it to begin with, they will have it like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, or Selah, 1, 2, 3, you know, the zero or the pause, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. The overs, and then 10, recipher. But verse 10, it says, if there come any to you, if there come any to I, now this is how we call it the universal churchical code. You know, if you want to see a copy of it, check it out on our website, the study page. There's a lot of shareable documentation there as well for one to study and to become informed. Verse 10 says, if there come any to you, so if any come to us as Beta Rastafari, as faithful ones and ones, right? Whether we're gathering in, you know, a home, a house, whether it's a house sort of square, or if it's a churchical sort of gathering, you understand, if one comes to us and brings not this doctrine, and it was one that said, yes, I am, but they don't have the teaching. How can you say, like, how can I say that I'm a police officer or a soldier, like in the United States Army, unless I have received training? And I have been received by them, but and received training. You know what I'm saying? So what it's saying, that if any come to us and they don't bring this doctrine, receive him not into your house. Don't receive them into the square. Don't receive them into the square. You can teach them. So you might have read in the scripture before, it says, and your children will speak to the enemies in the gate. No, we can teach them in the gate. We don't bring them in, but we can fellowship with them until they are taught, until they of their own free will, you'll then choose to make their wills obedient to good influences. Until that time, we can still preach to them, we can help them, and we're supposed to help them according to Christ, according to what we learn of Yeshua HaMashiach and the example of His Majesty. But we're not friends. We're not friends on that sort of level with them, and we're not fellows. And according to Christ, they are not our brethren or sisterin or mothers in Rastafari either, unless they bring that teaching. You understand? Unless they bring that teaching. Remember what His Majesty has so said to us? He said, for my part, I glory in the Bible. It says, so receive him not into your house. And here was the key thing. It says, neither bid him Godspeed. Now, this might be difficult to some of you people who like being nice. You know, people who like to be overly nice. You think you have to so-called bless everybody in God's name. But what you don't recognize is that the word of Jah is not mocked. He is not mocked. You know what I'm saying? Every word of his is true. And if you add to it saying that, well, I can bless people in Jah, but people think, well, if I do that, I'm going to bring them to Jah. And I've heard stories and testimonies of this. And it's interesting when you hear it and when you're informed that you know the word and you know the truth. It's kind of like it proves other areas of the scripture. You know, when you reason and people testify to you, and some things you read and you accept it because you read it, but you still want to learn it. And then you start to listen to other folks' testimony, and you'd be like, wow, I never did that, but that almost, see, you see how it goes the wrong way. Because now you look at the reality, at the doctrine, at the teaching, and now you're seeing a living example of how it's going wrong. You understand? So it says, neither bid him God's feet. I had to look that up. In the Royal Amharic, it means neither say salam, neither say peace. You know, neither say salam, neither say peace. You know what I mean? Like, peace out. I honestly hate that one. I really hate that one. That time, peace out. Peace out what? You know, peace out. You know, or are you peace or something? So you're leaving, me in a state of war or something like that? I mean, what's this peace out thing? What religion is that? What culture or custom is that? What tribe does that? You know, it's in the tribe of ignoramus, of the tribe of the idiodotes. You know what I'm saying? And there's such a people. Some of the great philosophers in the European tradition speak about some of those types, right? Because they were studying in Egypt and, you know, gaining wisdom and growing up. You know what I'm saying? It says, so neither bid him Godspeed, neither bid him salam. Neither bid that one salam, basically. Nah, you can't come in the house. Go. Because you're bringing some, you're bringing in a counterfeit of fraud. You know what I'm saying? You're bringing in something that has no place in his house. You want to say, well, I and I don't deal with religion. Really? So what does this mean? What is this word of his, so this word of his majesty, says right here, have you read the Amharic of it? Do you even recognize this is the teaching of his majesty? Progress without religion. Notice this. We left off there, and I think we're going to conclude this part right here. So it says, neither receive him into your house. Don't Kabbalah him. And Kabbalah, it's interesting, the Kabbalah, the whole link with the hand in the scripture. Hand is symbolic of power, and hand is symbolic of, like, authority, reception. You understand? When it says, like, the hand, life and death is in the power of the tongue. In Proverbs 18, verse 20 and 21 go together, but I think it's 18 and 21. Life and death is in the power, right, of the tongue. But if you read it in the Hebrew, it is in the, not power of the tongue, but it's in the hand of the tongue. And then I did a little search. I like to do this. I see it in Hebrew, and that's an old, ancient kind of, almost like the Egyptian mystery school way. And if you know about Amenhotep and the Psalms, it's kind of interesting. And yes, there's a connection, but it's not like Solomon stole it, like a lot of y'all black consciousness supremacists believe. How much Amharic and Gutas do you speak? That's the real question right there. So you don't know about our culture. You've heard about our culture, but you don't know our culture. You know what I'm saying? So the word hand is to also to receive, like to kevele. You know, don't receive him into your house. Don't salute that one. Neither bid him Godspeed. Neither bid him salam. Because when we bid salam, see, this is a whole other level. It's almost like when they say to you in the law that if you're running around with somebody who's being chased by police, right, like a fugitive, if you're a fugitive from the law, they can all say that you're an accomplice. If they did something, you don't know what they did, and they jump in your car and they're chilling with you and everything like that, and they look for that person, and it's your car, but you're with them. They impound the car, they arrest you, they put all these other kind of liens and everything against you. And you say, but I didn't have anything to do with what had happened before. But by virtue and by working operation of law, by the operandi of law, you are an accomplice. You were fellowshipping. You're saying, well, who is that to you? Oh, it's my friend. Oh, it's your friend. Yeah. Oh, I know him. You know him? What, is a friend of yours? You know how they always, when they ask you, they're trying to get it down, boil it down to basics. It's a guy you know? Where you know him from? Is it a friend of yours or something like that? I'm going to say really a friend, so it's acquaintance then. Trying to get you acquaintance. And know this, in their report, they're gonna put this. Most times they put exactly what you said, that the person was your acquaintance. Oh, acquaintance, oh, friend. Okay, they were fellowshipping. So they go to jail, you go to jail because their crime was so outrageous, so forth and so on. And they do this by the law. It might be framing mischief by law, as Psalm 94 and 20 says, but still it's operative. So now think about it for a moment. You say that's wrong. And would you say they can't do that? You wouldn't say they can't do that because they've already done that and they still do that. And only if you have a good advocate or a knowledgeable, rather, attorney or lawyer or something like that, can they really argue it in your favor. You understand? Where you don't go down, you still might, you know, suffer some penalties, you understand, for that. And then that makes people now, you know, cold up and I can't even, you know, drive you crazy because you'd be like, how could this happen? I just said what's up to so-and-so, you understand? And so it tells you about what company you keep, you know, what company you keep, you know, unless you're a slave to somebody or whatever, you know, you are either keeping that company willingly or you're doing this against your will. If you're doing it against your will, folks want to know, and the law will want to know, well, what did you do to try to get away? What did you do to try to get help? Oh, I didn't do nothing because I was so scared. It's like the law can't comp you. That's your own personal thing. You as a human being, even the law understands this, created in God's image and after his likeness, have a responsibility, unless you have some other deficiency, like something's wrong with your brain or something like that, and it can be diagnosable. Maybe then you can get off for like because you were schizoid or, you know, you was off your medication on a certain level. No pun intended, but that's how it goes. Verse 11 says, "For he that biddeth him," here's the real knocker on the head, right? Here's the real, you know, where you get one of these, you know, here's a real kind of hit on the head in a sense. "For he that biddeth him, Godspeed. He who bids him, salam, peace, my brother." You know what I mean? "He who bids him, Godspeed, is partaker of his evil deeds." Whoa, wow. You know, like when people be saying that, wow, wow. I mean, that's a real wow. When I read that, I read it before, but sometimes you read things and don't click. I mean, you get it, but you really don't get it. Maybe you're thinking something else. Maybe, you know, your attention is not focused. But there's a time when you go over it in faithful study, and you get a point, you're like, wow, I read this before, but I didn't get that. Other things had to happen in your life, other experiences, other growth. So now you have grown up to a level that you can understand this more in its proper context. "For he that biddeth," one who says salam to him, to this one who transgresseth and doesn't have, right, and abideth not in the doctrine. Notice that right there. It doesn't say don't bring one in your gate who want to learn, or in the church who want to learn. It's not saying that. You know, or one who want to hear the proclamation, the subket, or the sermon, or the preaching of the good news, or the message of salvation. It says, whosoever transgresseth, and abideth not. That means they begin to go astray little by little by little by little by little. They say a couple of things that are not in alignment with his majesty, then they say more things that are not in alignment, and it gets worse and worse. And there's a snowball effect. You understand? That wheel of life now begins to turn. "And for he that biddeth him, Godspeed, is partaker." I had to think on that and say, Yeshua, oh, son of his majesty, explain that one to me right there. How is that one a partaker? And then he says, "Do you not know spirit, soul, and body is one? Do you not know there's the psychical?" You see, the psychical, you start to get wrapped up on the level that people say, you know, they only believe in things they can see. And that's kind of foolish. Because why do you believe so-called something you can see? You see it there already. You know, I mean, that doesn't... But they don't understand the word belief or the real word behind that word. The real word that that is a false placeholder for. But you are caught up in the psychical debt. This is why when it says in prayer, this is why prayer is so important. Because in prayer and meditation, we actually confess and let go a lot of these things that have happened through the word, and we free up. It's like when ones repent and be born again, and they confess, and they feel like a weight has lifted off of them. You understand? Because part of the psychical level that we can't see is freed up. Some folks say, oh, why would I have to tell God? If he's God, he knows. You plan. You like the old timers used to say, you playing with your, like to say, coffin screw. You understand? In other words, you really playing too close to the edge right there. You know, but instead you should humble, not grumble. Because the reason why is not that the Almighty does not know. It's not that the God and Father of our Lord and Redeemer, Yeshua HaMashiach, doesn't know. It's so that now, through your faith in him, or your faith in his faith, you understand, and your willingness to make your will obedient to his good influence and to his good will. You know, because he's the only one that is good. He is the way, the truth, and the life. You are freed up. You know, you are freed up. And sometimes it's the most difficult thing for folks to even talk about it, even to themselves. Notice that bondage right there. You know, and Satan will like you to not say nothing, not even go in your closet and pray. And have faith and go in and pray. Even then, the devil will try hard to get you. Don't say it. Don't say nothing. Don't you even say it. But there's nobody around. Don't you say nothing. Because you know that cord will be broken in Christ. You know what I'm saying? That cord will be broken in the metaphysical, the spiritual Christ. You know what I'm saying? By that testimony to it. Because now, Christ has that word, that testimony, and on the spiritual level of the law, uses that, you know what I'm saying, in authority of the Father, you know what I'm saying, for the Father's child, for the I or I, for I and I. Now, you're going around, and you're telling somebody who might be doing all kind of crazy stuff, peace, you're saying by the use of your word, this is why it says, you know, watch your word. This is why we as Rastafari speak about word, sound, and power. It goes deeper than just this kindergarten level that so many folks have been exposed to over the last 30, 40 years. I mean, compared to where His Majesty has shown I and I, and where the true teaching of His Majesty lead I and I, that's like kindergarten, that's like pre-K maybe. Not even kindergarten, pre-K. So he that biddeth him Godspeed, Jahspeed, is partaker of evil deeds, of his evil deeds. That means that whatever evil deeds, now you bid them peace, and you already full well knew. It's not saying don't say peace of one, for you don't know what they're going to do. You understand? But if they are in the doctrine, in the teaching of Christ, you understand that nothing has shown up on the, no red flag, so to speak, has come up, you know, you wish them peace, you bid them peace. You understand? But you already know that this one is a hypocrite, a liar against the teacher of His Majesty, even when they're shown and proven and warned about it. You have a decision to make. You know what I mean? You and may Jah give you the strength in Yeshua. You understand? Now, let's continue. That's the section right there, verse 7 to verse 11. 7 to 11 of 2 John, the second epistle of John. Once again, His Majesty teaches us on true religion, on the RETU'A HAYMANOT, vis-a-vis Rastafari. And we say, is Rastafari a religion? You understand? Is it a religion? In the Ethiopian context, yes. So how should we answer that? Well, not in the European sense, but in the Ethiopian context, yes. You understand? In our Ethiopian context, yes it is. The RETU'A HAYMANOT. You understand? If you learn the pure language and you start to speak it and you start to articulate things, they'll be like, okay, we understand now. Okay, so what is your case about, sir? You know, and then you go through. You know what I mean? You know, you're moving in the law of Christ. You understand? It's not that screaming and hollering and foaming at the mouth. It's not that false counterfeit religion kind of a thing there. You understand? it is true religion. In other words, to make our wills obedient to good influences and to avoid evil is to show the greatest wisdom. In order to follow this aim, one must be guided by religion. Guided. Remember the Ethiopian eunuch, Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8? He was reading Tindate Isaiah, Shishayu, or the prophet Isaiah. And when he was reading the prophet Isaiah, Philip caught up to the chariot and said, my friend, do you understand what you're reading? And what did he say? He said, get away from me, man. I'm reading, man. I know what I'm doing. He said, I can't read. He didn't go through all that mixed up mood and attitude. He said, how can I unless someone guide me? You know, so his he had the Holy Spirit. You know what I'm saying? Or we used to call him Rastafari. He had the right vibes. He had the vibes. He had the Isla Iris, the right vibration, you know, he was on the right spiritual. All those words are words that describe another way. Some say there's no spirit. The reason why Rasta said that then is because of the spiritualism in the counterfeit Christianity that it was exposed to, that it was using this word, but it had nothing to do with the true root of that word. So one's throughout the baby and the bath water. Get the baby. You understand? Forget the bath water. You know, it's been used already. In order to follow this aim, one must be guided by religion. So we must be guided by the living faith, the RETU'A, HAYMANOT, the living faith. Or in English, or speaking to English people, especially in court, religion. Yes. You know, I got rights. I'm not waiving my rights. Progress. This is what we're saying. How come there's a lack of progress among I and I, Rastafari? We don't have this and we should be doing that. How come a lack of progress, you know, right? That's what we're talking about, right? There's no secret business. You understand? There's no secret society. That's the reality. Progress without religion. So now we see why there's a lack of progress among I and I. We look at other groups. You understand? Even some of these new ages. You know, I mean, ones that Scientology, I mean, what is that? But boom, they were the progress. Everybody's progressing. What is up with I and I? So we're not just shaming ourselves, but we're shaming the King of Kings and his Christ. We're shaming this true way. You know what I'm saying? Which is for the salvation. It's for salvation, not for damnation. Progress without the two HAYMANOT or HAYMANOT is just like a life. Right? A life, a liberty, a life surrounded by unknown perils. 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 And can be compared to a body without a soul. I'm going to hit something. You know, like when in the thing, you'd be like, you hit, you know, it's like, that's a hit right there. You got to check that word right there. So this is the teaching of His Majesty, you know, of Haile Selassie. A.K.A. with a new name, Rastafari Jah, Rastafari. So, you know, every man got to, you know, decide his own destiny. I guess that's how it has to be. So, one decides for the teaching of His Majesty, then I and I is one, and may we work and pray and work to become one. If one's one decide against this, y'all can go to hell, basically. Sheol. You want to call it Sheol? The Isata Gehana, Gehana, you know, wherever, you know, but go elsewhere, because you're not going nowhere, really, or stay stuck, because progress is moving. You know, progress is necessary to have living faith. You know why it's so necessary? Because, see, living faith is just that, living faith. You know what I'm saying? Living faith, living trust. We have trust in the one who created I and I, and in our brothers and sisters. So that means if two agree on earth, nothing is impossible to them. We see the heathen and the sheathen doing this all the time about things that we shake our heads and say, no, that can't work. But because they agree on it, you know what I'm saying, they are able to make it happen and sometimes even draw us and draw other people into that. You know what I'm saying? You see how faith, just the principle of faith, we need to understand. And then we need to understand the true faith. Progress without religion is just like a life surrounded by unknown perils, unknown dangers, and can be compared to a body without a soul. So that's like somebody has lost their soul. They need their soul restored to them. You know what I'm saying? So that he restores our soul. Let's bring the 23rd Psalm in right here, because the Spirit says, the Holy Spirit said, this really links the 23rd Psalm, you understand, with this idea, rightly dividing the word of truth. Here it says, the Lord, Yahweh, is Roi, you understand? Yahweh is my shepherd, is I shepherd. I shall not want. What does it mean? Never to use the word want. I can't say I want something. No. The word want means to lack. There's nothing that I am caused to lack or miss out on. In a sense, asata is kind of linked, ata, with chatiyat, both in the Hebraic and in the Ethiopic, as well as the royal and hard. So it means that I will not lack anything. You know, he's my shepherd. The shepherd takes care of the sheep, right? He maketh me to lie down. He maketh I to lie down in green pastures, in the green pastures. You know, I mean, for all the green, not just the conibosum, but all the green. You know what I'm saying? Nature. You know what I'm saying? Even this green that we have in our banner of salvation in the imperial flag with the Yehuda Moa Anbesa Arma on it, that green, you understand, the green in the level means that's ear. It relates to the ear and the green we have with the tree of life, and you can just link all the green. Georgis colors green, the angel Mikael colors green, so it's just a very wonderful place, the heart chakra. You understand, the Christ chakra, the chakra of righteousness, is green as well. So he maketh thine eye to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters, the restful waters, not the troubled waters, the choppy sea that we see in Revelation. It says in that day and time the seas will roar and will rage. No, he leadeth thine eye beside the still waters. You understand? Almost like the waters of the Red Sea. They were still, boom, you know, like a wall. You understand? And that's real high science. He restores my soul. Boom. There you go. He restoreth. That means he sends back to me my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. He leads, he guides I and I. As the teaching of his majesty guides I and I in the path of righteousness